Well, good morning, Swift. It is a beautiful day, nice and cool as we start hitting these summer days. So welcome everyone to our Sunday worship. Before we get started, let's go through a few announcements. All of you been hearing about this fantastic getaway. We got to look forward to that, which is in the beginning of July. So it's from the 2nd to the 4th. We have a lot of people who have signed up. So thank you very much for that response. We have, in fact, about 80% of occupancy already registered there. So please do get in there and sign up earlier so we can make sure that we have a slot for you there. A few photographs of this place. People have been asking, what does it look like? All right, well, there was a picture used of the beach. Unfortunately, there's no beach and the sea over there, but this is a place in Jinshan, which is not far. In fact, from here, it's probably around 40 minutes drive from the Xujing area. As you can see there, it's beautiful. It's got a lot of places you can walk around with a lot of flowers and gardens, and there's some water there as well. So and it's a really a great environment, very beautiful. What do the rooms look like? They really are five-star rooms. So you can see there on the left is a sitting area, and there are two rooms in each unit. As you can see, there's one bigger room and then there's a smaller room. So two rooms in each unit. So it's really a lovely place. So please do get in there and sign up for that. We're looking forward to it. It's going to be a great time of being together, just sharing fellowship and enjoying each other's presence. We're still going through our coronavirus period, and of course we know that in July is the 100th year anniversary for the party, and so we can expect a lot of restrictions. So please do keep that in mind as we be sensitive at this time and really be appreciative of what we do have right now. We are still not getting back to Zhuentang, but I think a lot of people are enjoying their time in Suzhou, aren't you? Hi to those people in Suzhou today. And so for those in Suzhou, really have a great time with the kids there as well, and enjoy today's service. The giving, please do go ahead and provide your offerings and tithings. We've made it convenient that you can do it through WeChat and Alipay. But again, there, we're doing that only for a convenience sake. It can be too large amounts. We don't want put through this part. So if it's more than 2,000 or a larger amount, or if you're able to do a bank transfer, please do get hold of me. Send me a message and we'll enable that, make sure that you have all of that information. We also have ways that you can give overseas in certain ways. Yeah, we have many ways that you can give. So don't just restrict yourselves to WeChat and Alipay. Get a hold of me and let me know that you're willing in other ways to give. So you can do that at any time. And go ahead before or after the service to do your giving. So without further ado, let us begin today. We're going to begin by a reading of the Psalms. I think I'm reading today, right? So I'm going to be reading the Psalms today. Let's read this together. We're taking it from Psalm 39, verses 7 to 13. Let's join together. But now, Lord, what do I look for? My hope is in you. Save me from all my transgressions. Do not make me the scorn of fools. I was silent. I would not open my mouth, for you are the one who has done this. Remove your scourge from me. I am overcome by the blow of your hand. When you rebuke and discipline anyone for their sin, you consume their wealth like a moth. Surely everyone is but a breath. Hear my prayer, Lord. Listen to my cry for help. Do not be deaf to my weeping. I dwell with you as a foreigner, a stranger, as all my ancestors were. look away from me, that I may enjoy life again before I depart and am no more. Let us pray. O most holy and loving Father, we look to you and away from the worries and the problems of this world. May all praise and honor and glory be unto your name. May your kingdom come here on earth as it is in heaven. As we come together, we ask, Holy Spirit, that you may join us together. Help us cast out anything of the world and the matters that are bothering us right now. And help us to come into the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ. Help us to turn away from the things of the storm and look towards Jesus. Help us right now as we sing these praises to you. May they truly be from a heart of worship, that we may sing, that we may feast upon these words and sing them to you, that we may glorify your name, that the word you speak to us today, we may receive it as if it's spoken directly from you, that we may receive your blessing. And in your presence, Lord, we may worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Morning, everyone. Are you joyful today?
Yes.
Amen. Can we rise, invite you to rise for the worship song together? Shall we start?
Lost, I was in chains, the world had a hold of me. My heart was a stone, I was covered in shame. When he came for me, I couldn't run from his presence. I couldn't run from his arms. Jesus, he loves me, he loves me, it is for me. Jesus, how can it be? He loves me, it is for me. It was a fire deep in my soul, I'll never be the same. I step out of the dark into the light. When he called my name, I couldn't run from his presence. I couldn't run from his arms. He loves me, he loves me, it is for me. Jesus, how can it be? He loves me, it is for me. He holds the stars and he holds my heart with healing hands that bear the scars. Love us.
Agree? Amen.
How great is our God, sing with me, how great is our God, oh, we'll see how great is our God, the splendor of the King. Clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. Trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God, sing with me, how great is our God, oh, we see how great is our God. Age to age he stands, time is in his hands, beginning at the end, beginning at the end. The God is three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God, sing with me, how great is our God, oh, see how great is our God.
Father God, you are so great, Father God, that you are able to gather us today. And today is your day that, Father God, we are all able to sing, to worship you, Father God. Thanks for giving us this chance to gather here to worship you in this manner. We do not care about what kind of weather or situations, But we just want to give thanks that we are able to come together to worship you here with one heart and with one unity. So right now, Father God, we just want to give thanks. And today is your day that we are all glorified your name. And today we call you Abba Fathers, and you will be with us one and forever. Amen. Please take a seat, and we are doing our offering song.
You are God.
Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, thank you so much for wonderful grace that we know you are God. You're the only God. You are our Father in heaven. You are our Savior. You are our protector, and also you are our provider, so that we can be still in you, Lord. Especially in this pandemic period, Lord, let us have a peaceful heart in our mind, because as we walk with you every day, many times we fell into temptation, we fell into challenges, we fell into many needs. Lord, let us all focus on you, because you are our Father. And Lord, thank you so much for giving us the hope and the faith in you. Lord, may you continue to bless all those who are in illness, even including our beloved one. Lord, be with them, heal them, guide them, and also comfort them. Let them knowing that you'll be always with them. And Lord, for those who don't know about tomorrow, in worries, in challenges, Lord, may you shed your light onto them. Let them know in the darkness, you're still guiding them. Let them see the light through the tunnel. Let them have hope in you. And also, Lord, may you bless all those youth who've been having a summer vacation. Lord, be with them. Let them be able to spare all the extra time to know you, to study the Bible, to pray to you. And also, may you bless them as they continue to have fellowship together. Give them your mercy and love. And also for those who are graduating this year to pursuing for their college degree, Lord, be with them. Let them have your spirit with them all the time. As we're facing a new chapter in their life, let them have courage. Let them have the strength. Let them have the faith in you, so that when they encounter all the temptation and challenge, when they moving to a new place and a new school, Lord, let them stay in you and also being protected by you. And Lord, for those children and middle schooler, they are promoting to the next grade, Lord, be with them. As they grow in their knowledge, at the same time, let them grow in their spiritual life. Let them be strong. Let them knowing that you are the Father, loving him no matter how young they are. And also let them able to grow maturely in spirit, so that they know you all the time, so that in their whole life, they know what does it mean to be still in you. And may your Holy Spirit come upon us, give us a humble heart to listen to your message, and able to open our heart to transform ourselves to be closer to you. We pray all this in Jesus' victorious name. Amen. Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you through online. And also, today, we have a big announcement. Thank you so much for Ian to share the picture with you all. Hopefully it get you more excited, because I know many people ask about the question, where are we going and how's the facility going to look like, and also what are we going to do? As what I mentioned in the WeChat group, because of the sensitivity reason, so we cannot post too much thing. So we are in the challenge of we want everyone to know and get excited of what's going on, but on the meantime, we need to find the right media so we're not trigger alert or causing any challenges into preparation of this event. So that's why we call it getaway. It's not a retreat, it's a family getaway. And hopefully from the picture, you know that we're gonna have a really nice facility. The main focus of the getaway is for us to get together, because during the pandemic, we cease major gathering. We don't have a regular small group gathering and even Bible study fellowship. So we want to have the time that we can get together, the whole church, for family to know each other, to have a good time together, especially if, although we don't call it a retreat, right? But we're going to treat it like a retreat. What's retreat mean? You're going to retreat from your daily living and then have a quiet time to connect to God. So that's what we're going to focus on. We're not going to give you tons of lecture, tons of teaching for like 2 hours, 3 hours. We're going to focus on how we're going to interact God's word with us. We have a sharing time, so we can talk about different topics, share about our challenges in our life, in the group. And also we're going to have a time that we're going to test to share our testimonies to each other. So what happened to us for the past 3 years, we're going to give you a time that you can share experience to each other, to encourage each other. And then, although on Sunday, July 4th, we were not going to have our official worship service, but we're going to come together to sing, to pray, to read the scripture together. And you will enjoy that Sunday because your pastor is not going to preach. Okay, I'm going to get some words for you. Maybe I will read some scripture and do some little sharing, but not preaching. So enjoy a Sunday without a pastor preaching to you. Okay, you need to join the getaway. Just kidding. Okay. Anyway, so hope you find out the getaway will be a good time to get together. If you're in Shanghai, I will encourage to join. The price is really reasonable, 300 yuan per person from age 10 and above for the whole getaway, including accommodation, including the meals, all the expenses, 300 per person. For family, we're going to have a ceiling of the cost of 1200. So it means if you have 7-8 people in your direct family, you can all join us and it will be still charged 1200 only. And also for age 10 and under, it's going to be free. But in the meantime, you know that this is a ridiculous attractive price for the cost for the getaway, so that the Swift will subsidize quite a bit of the expenses. So I will encourage you to give love offering. If you feel God give you abundant blessing financially this year, and you want to give a special offering, this is the place you can give offering to support others, to support Swift, because we are facing financial challenges right now. But in the meantime, we want to encourage everyone to come and join. Just like today, when we talk about manna, it's the gift of God. So God provides us in our daily needs. So this is time that we want people to come together to enjoy the fellowship together. So if you feel the Holy Spirit touch you, you want to support through the special offering, feel free to do so. You can go through I will encourage you to go through to contact Ian so that you can get the bank transfer information. You can do some offering, as what we mentioned, not over 2,000 yuan through the QR code. But if you go through the QR code, it's not you don't have a way to specify it's for the getaway. So we're going to collect it as a general offering. It's still fine because we only have one fund for Swift anyway. Oh, let's continue on the story of Exodus. Last week we talked about, last time when I preached on the Exodus 3 weeks ago, we talked about the instant that they crossed the Red Sea. Now the Egyptian army being destroyed, they're in the desert. And let's start with a question. So as what we talk about manna, we're going to talk about this as daily bread from the Lord. So I want to ask you to think about, do you recognize your daily bread from the Lord nowadays? Because definitely we are not able to collect manna nowadays. But what's it mean when we talk about daily bread? What does that mean to you? And have you been recognizing that from the Lord? And let me give you a background of the story, where it starts with. From Exodus chapter 16, verse 1 to 3, it said, "The whole Israelite community set out from Elim and came to the desert of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai." So they haven't reached Sinai yet, the Mount of Sinai. On the 15th day of the second month after they have come out of Egypt. So Moses was so precise on when this thing happens, the blessing of the manna. It's 2.5 months, basically, after they left Egypt. In the desert, the whole community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt, there we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we want. But you have brought us out into this desert to starve this entire assembly to death. What's it mean?" So after they left Egypt 2.5 months later, it seems like they are lacking of food. So they complain to God, they grumble to Moses. That's not the worst. They compare to the old days. Remember when we start the book of Exodus from the chapter 1, they say because they are under heavy slavery under the Egyptian. So they complain, they cry to God, "God, save us." So after they pray for so many times, they left Egypt 400 years after they entered Egypt, Joseph and Jacob. So they've been praying for a long time. Finally, God heard their prayer and delivered them, exiled them from Egypt. But then 2.5 months later, because they lack of food, they complain. And then they complain what? When we were in Egypt, we can set around pots. Maybe think about hot pots, okay? Think about the Chinese hot pots. We gather at the hot pot place. They have meat, they have foods, so they can enjoy the time. They thought this is a good, they have a good time in Egypt, which they were not. God is bringing them to the promised land that God said to them that they're going to have flow of honey and milk. But they don't see that. They forgot about all this promise. They forgot all the 10 plagues that God have done for them. They forgot God had opened the Red Sea for them. They forgot all this. All they remember, I have a good time in the old days. And they compare with God's blessing. So that's why they complain. But God, I think God is really a merciful God. Lucky that I'm not God. If I'm the Father in heaven, I'm probably going to sack them, right? Keep complaining to me. Here, but no, God have mercy for them. So God gives them manna. So what is manna? And according to the scripture, say when the Israelites saw it, they said to each other, "What is it?" And actually, that's what manna really means. What is it? They saw that thing. They have no idea what's that. So they say, "Manna." That's what is it? So for they did not know what it was. So manna is the food that God provided to them. Every day, according to scripture, it says every day God will have the food ready in the early morning. All they need to do is just collect those manna from the ground, and then they will have enough portion for their daily consumption. So this is what God provided to them. And also from the scripture, we can only have a glimpse of a slim of it, of what it really looked like, because nowadays we definitely don't know what manna look like, okay? But according to the scripture, it says the people of Israel called the bread manna. It was white like coriander seed and tastes like waffles made with honey. So it tastes like honey, first of all, and then it looked like coriander seed. It's not coriander seed, but look like. So we have to be careful on the scripture. Okay, if you go to Numbers, the book of Numbers, that chapter 11 and verse 7 to 9, that's how they explain it. The manna was like coriander seed and looked like raisin. So now you have a little bit more idea. Okay, it looked like raisin and also it looked like coriander seed. The people went around gathering it and then ground it in a handmill or crush it in a mortar. They cooked it in a pot and make it into loaves. And it tastes like something made with olive oil. So first of all, in Exodus, it says it tastes like honey, and now it tastes like olive oil. No matter how you interpret it, so it tastes like honey and olive oil, it must taste really good. It tastes good. And all they need to do, they just need to pick it up. And this is what the manna looked like according to scripture. So, and what we can learn from this story of manna, I think from the manna, we find out a few things. First of all, it was sufficient. Because according to scripture, every day they will gather the manna. So everyone had gathered just as much as they need. And they measure the amount of manna they collect by something called omer. Okay, but this is kind of a unit they calculate. So you can have one omer, two omer. So and one interesting thing they said, okay, so say the Israelites did, oh, sorry. One interesting thing they said is because the one who gathered much did not have too much, and the one who gathered little did not have too little. What's it mean? So let's say if my family is one of the Israelite family in those states. So when I collect, maybe I'm able to collect more than my daughter, Asanov. And Asanov, maybe she went out to collect. I can collect, let's say, 10 omers. And Asanov only can collect half omer. But at the end of the day, when we collect all this and go back home, we find out the 10 omer I collect is not too much. It's still a portion of what I need. And then the portion, the half omer that Asanov collect is still not too little. It's sufficient for her. This is very important because it means the manna is really God's gift. It's not that the harder you work, the more you gain. The less you work, the less you gain. But the main thing, you just need to go collect it. That's important. I'm going to talk about that later when I talk about daily. But this is something that they need to do. But the result is not important, because the result is led by God. And secondly, it's light. I try to make the acronym of one single word. So what I really means is light in the workload. It's light because imagine nowadays, I do have a brother and sister sometimes talk to me and saying that how challenged their work is, especially under the pandemic. I think everyone being suffer a lot in the workload because now you have to work from home, but it doesn't mean it's easier for you because you have all the meetings, right? And now also you need to work at the weekends, you have to work basically everywhere. Even the children, I heard about it for the half year and a half, when we have online school, but it doesn't mean easier because we have suffered, the teacher have hard time to communicate with the children. And then you have lots of questions you want to ask, but time's limited. And everyone is need to put a lot of effort in maintaining their daily work. And also in Chinese saying, we always say, why we work so hard? Because we just try to make a living. We try to feed our mouth. That's what basically trying to say from Chinese. So all we work nowadays, all the incomes, all the salary, just to feed our mouth so I can survive. This is their it's Chinese concept. Right, so we've been working hard to survive, to gather all the food we can, to have a roof so we can stay. But in here, it say the Israelites, they can collect. And remember, I said earlier, the manna, it tastes like something made with olive oil. It tastes good. When I went to the Israel trip 2 years ago, I went to a place that they kind of like built a village in Jesus' time, in Galilee, in Nazareth. So this place is kind of like a place you can come, visit, observe how people live around 2000 years ago. So I took this picture. This is a stone mill that they used to squeeze the olive oils from the olive. So you can imagine, you have to put all those olive onto this mill, and then you have to keep pushing it, right? Running and pushing. So now finally, you get some olive oil. So it reminds me when I read the numbers, it say the manna tastes like olive oil. So in my imagination, that can you imagine you just collect something that it tastes like olive oil, but you don't need to put all the hard work on it. You don't need to go through all the squeezing and pushing and collecting. It's all there. And it also tastes like honey. I mean, imagine how you collect honey. It's not easy, right? You have to have bees, you have to have honeycombs, right? And all these things, but you don't. Whatever you collect, it gives you all the taste, good taste, all the nutritious, all the things you need. So the workload is light when you talk about collecting manna compared to what they usually need to work, because 2000 years ago, they don't have internet, they don't have computers, right? They need to farm, they need to grow, they need to take care of their cattle in order to have food supply. But now all they need to do is just wake up and collect. So the workload is light. So maybe you ask, Pastor, then why God just make it even simpler, that God just show the manna into their household? Like every day, you wake up, you go to your kitchen, you have a bowl of manna ready for you. Isn't it great, right? But I think God wants them to follow. Next week, we're going to talk about manna, which is test from God. Today, I'm going to talk about manna as a gift from God. So I want us to focus on this is from God. It's a heavenly gift from God. But next week, I'm going to talk about this actually also a test from God. And this is part of a test. God wants them to evolve into his will. God is providing them, no doubt about that, but you need to follow his order. He told the Israelites they need to collect the manna in a daily basis, except Saturday. On the Sabbath day, there's nothing going to show on the ground and nothing they can collect. So they need to collect double portion of the manna the day before on Friday. So on Saturday, they all don't do any work. They all quiet from their work and observe and worship their Lord. So I cannot think of any plants, any things on this nature that it will only show up every day at the morning, but it knows, oh, today is Saturday, so I'm not coming out. So this is the only thing I ever heard of, like plants, food, whatever, natural stuffs, okay, that will only appear on 6 days and then stop on 1 day and then come back on the next date. And also next week, we're going to talk about more about it because like, it got rotten if you try to keep it for overnight, except on Friday night. So I'm going to explain more about that. But overall, today, I want to emphasize the workload is light. Even God wants you to involve in his plan and his will. Usually, God take care of most of the work for you. All you need to just follow and involve. At last, I want to mention from Paul verse that in verse 10 and 22nd, it say, the blessing of the Lord brings wealth without painful toil for it. I think many of us, when we talk about work, as what I mentioned earlier, we work day and night. We travel a lot. We wake up at 1 a.m. still answering emails or WeChat calls, right? We sound kind of like we try to make a living with our own strength, own effort. It's painful. But in here, in Proverbs, it says, just like manna, the blessing and the gift from the Lord, being wealth, is sufficient, is gift, is good enough, it will be enough for us to survive, to even have some savings, I believe, and enjoy our life, and most important, without painful toil for it. We don't need to give extra effort. Just follow God. And this is what God given to Israelites through manna. And last is also, it's daily. Every day and in the morning, there was a layer of dew around the camp, every morning. So every day it came up. Can you imagine, maybe some Israelite, they were saying, God, what happened if I get sick? What happened if I got tired? Oh God, can I have one more day of rest? So why don't you give me 2 or 3 days? Why don't you give me a week of portions so I collect at once so I can get rest? But amazingly, God make these things happen in a daily basis. So every day they need to come up. They need to come up from the camp, collect and enjoy the blessing from God. But you can think, oh God, I don't want to work every day. But on the other hand, I think God wants to do this because God wants to show them I've been with you in a daily basis. Right? Many Christians, they were at, when we pray, we ask God, God, give me all the things I need. God, I'm studying for the college right now. God, give me good grade all the time. God, I want to be smart right now. Give me all the smartness so I can stay for the whole study of college time. Maybe for some people, we want to work. And then nowadays, I find out a lot of young adults, they want to work so hard so that they can have early retirement at the age of 35 and 40. So you want to make enough in a short period of time so you can survive for the rest of your life. So that's why life is so tough. But on the other hand, will you pray to the Lord? Lord, okay, you give me enough right now. So you don't need to come to me every day, just once a week. Lord, show yourself to me. Lord, give me all your gift and your protection once a week. That's sufficient enough. No, right? When we pray, God, be with us every single second, every single minute of my life. So God did that through manna. Every day, God showed it to the Israelites. I'm providing to you. What's that mean? I've been with you. Day by day, just walk with me. So I think that's a very important lesson that God gives to us. So the Lord doesn't give us everything at once, but the Lord wants us to walk with him in a daily basis. So that's why in my discipleship classes, I always mention to them, you need to do your daily devotion. You don't try to read the whole Bible in 2 days and say, God, done. I'm not going to read the Bible for 5 years. No, God wants us to read the Bible every day because every day we'll have new experience in him. And every day we need to pray to the Lord because every day God wants us to talk to him. So the gift, the eternal gift of Christ, doesn't mean that we're going to see God finally when the time we enter into heaven. In the meantime, we don't need to do anything. No, God is going to walk with us in the daily basis. And also, as I mentioned earlier, so you have to do it in a daily basis that no one is to keep any of it until morning. So if you're trying to collect a lot and say, oh God, I don't need to do tomorrow, I don't need to collect it tomorrow, can, because the Israelites, they did that. They kept part of it until morning, but was full of maggots and began to smell. So it's rotten that they cannot eat it. But amazingly, the one they collect on Friday night, they can stay for one more date. And so this is what God provided to them. And I want to go to Matthew chapter 6, verse 31 and 34. This is a really popular scripture from Jesus, the teaching from Jesus that talk about our day-to-day needs. What it said is, so do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? And what shall we drink? And what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all the things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all this thing will be given to you as well. Let's take a look at the scripture I highlighted with what it says. Your heavenly Father knows that you need them. This is very important, because when we take a look at the scripture, some people misinterpret it. I think they interpret our needs more like the Buddhism. Okay, in the Buddhism, what they think, don't have anything, don't own anything. They say everything on the earth is troubles and sorrows and problems. So that's why the monks, they try to segregate themselves from this world and living in a really barely in a basic living that they just survive and they meditate all the time. That's what the Buddhism thought, right? And some people interpret this similar to the way some people, they will keep telling others, we don't need money. We don't need to make bread. We don't need to be a breadwinner. We don't need to make a living because God will provide. No, this is not the scripture say. If you take a look at verse 32, it says, for the pagans run after. These two words very important, run after. What's that mean? So you mean for the non-believers, they pursued for all the things, what to eat, what to drink, and what to wear, as the meaning of their whole life. That's what the scripture means. What Jesus said, don't pursue for all this as your own purpose and meaning of your life. You need that. God knows. So that's why the scripture says your heavenly Father knows that you need them. So Jesus never said you don't need them. Jesus never said you believe in me, you never starve again. You never need to eat, or you never need to drink. Jesus said, we know you need this to upkeep your life, but this is not the meaning of your life. Your meaning of life is now, is in me. This is what Jesus Christ said. So that's why he said, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. This is the purpose and the meaning of our life as we are the followers of Christ. But God will provide all this. So from the story of manna, we know that God provided the need of the Israelites a few thousand years ago. And now in Christ, God will do the same thing to us. God will provide. But how are we able to put our faith onto it? I think it's very important we put our priority, we set our priority right. Next week, I'm going to talk about, as what I say, the test from God. Why we have tests from God? Because God wants us to learn how to learn about obedience, how to follow him. And he always has the best will for us and best plans too. So we need to learn from God's daily provision that we need to follow him. And then once we know God provides, then we can put all our attention, our focus onto what? Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. And that's the whole meaning. So the manna is really a gift from God so that Israelites can get closer to God. Now Jesus said, for the manna is going to cease, and when they collect the manner, they have to do it every day. But for him, he's the bread for eternity. In Jesus, we have all the blessing, all the provision, all the guidance in him. But brother and sister, are we able to recognize this? Are we able to recognize this and knowing that God has given you daily bread, day by day? Have you recognized what's that? We have a job, we have a family, we have a health, we have protection from God. All this being given to us in a daily basis. And also God give us a place we can worship him. I think the pandemic really give us a good lesson, because we've been taking it for granted. It's always a church open on Sunday. It's always a place we can go worship. But no, not necessary. Right now, we still suspended our worship service. We have to do it online. We still do it in a not perfect way, but hopefully our worshiping heart is perfect. We can all come together and worship him. So we still need to praise the Lord, because he's been providing us all the need. So brother and sister, at this time, I want to challenge you after today's worship service to pray to the Lord, to recognize, to pray to the Lord, to thank the daily bread he's given to you. And which is different, it could be different to every single individuals. But I believe every single person in Christ, you recognize God being providing in a daily basis. Examine yourself and pray to the Lord today and start to learn, count your blessing in a daily basis. Then you find out, actually, God is so close to you. And God is willing to let you experience him in a daily basis. Since many times we miss that, and also we're acting like the Israelites, we just grumble and complain. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, thank you so much for wonderful grace that you've been always with us. And Lord, thank you for providing us our daily bread so that we know you're God, and also you're God that being with us in a daily basis. Lord, let us recognize your existence. Let us recognize that we're living in your presence. Let's spend our efforts into seeking your kingdom and your righteousness. Let's don't worry about daily needs, because we know, Lord, you are a providing God. And Lord, may you continue to bless every single individual as we come to you and ask for your mercy, ask for your love. Lord, let's show and reveal yourself to us. We pray all this in Jesus' victorious name. Amen.
Can I invite everyone to rise for the closing song? Anything. You alone
You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you, and I long to worship you.
Before the benediction, just one reminder that we have an offering box. If you're in SoSo, that we have an offering box. Feel free to scan the QR code or give your offering into the box too. One thing I forgot to mention, I need to mention it to you, that some of you may know that the Pudo International Fellowships, for what I know, the AGIF, the Cantonese International Fellowship, and the Thanksgiving English Sunday School, that's the official names, okay. The Thanksgiving English Sunday School from led by Pastor Jason Kim, they start to reopen time by time. Right now, the strategy from the government is first open the International Fellowship at Pudong first. And we have no news on the Pusi side yet, on the west side. So just continue to pray for it and see how things go. And also pray for all those international fellowship at Pudong. Hopefully everything will run smoothly so that they can demonstrate that it's safe to reopen all the international fellowship. That may be able to speed up our reopenings too. So continue to pray for each other and let's walk with God in a daily basis and let God to provide all the manner to us. Let's bow our head and receive the benediction. May the love of our Father and the grace of His Son, Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us from now and forever. Amen. Goodbye and see you next week.